All right, in this video, we'll be looking at membrane permeability. Been looking at the cell membrane, and so now we'll look at things that it allows in and out. So we talked about the fluid mosaic model. We talked about how a bilayer will spontaneously form in the presence of water because the phospholipids have a hydrophilic portion, which is these heads, and a hydrophobic portion, which are these tiny little tails here. And when you put them in water, the hydrophobic portions will get close to one another, and then the hydrophilic portions will get close to the water. And so they form this kind of bilayer here. And we call it a fluid mosaic model because it's not static, it's dynamic, it's constantly moving around. And as you can see, it's made of lots of different pieces. One of the functions of the plasma membrane is selective permeability. Sometimes you'll see it called selectively permeable, which is just the backwards opposite of that. What does that mean? It only allows certain things in. You can see this little picture here showing that it allows the passage of the red dots and not the blue dots. A couple of things here. Small nonpolar molecules can pass freely. So like a nitrogen gas, which is N2 or O2 oxygen gas, CO2, even nonpolar gas can pass right through the membrane. Very small molecules, hydrophilic substances, really big molecules or ions, they cannot freely move through, and they need a channel protein in order to do that. And here's a couple of pictures of those. So you have, this is a channel protein, which is just like a little tube. And these green hexagons are, some have some kind of charge, obviously. And so they need to go through a tube in order to get through there. And that tube then has the same sort of charge as that. So that tube is specifically designed for green hexagons. Then there are carrier proteins, which are more like, think of like a revolving door. It's a moving piece, whereas this is just a tube. This is actually a piece that's moving things. So it's going and getting these ovals and pushing them through the other side. And so it's carrying those molecules through, again, specifically designed for a certain sort of thing, not just any kind of thing. Small polar molecules, like H2O, are able to pass through the cell membrane in small amounts. Large amounts of water or large amounts of polar molecules will have to find another way. And even for water, there are special kinds of protein channels for water called aquaporins, and they're able to allow water as well. Let's talk a little about the cell wall. Cell walls are found in several kinds of organisms. The cell wall primarily provides a structural boundary, protects and maintains the shape of the cell. It also prevents the cell from rupturing. So like this plant cell, for instance, has a large central vacuole that's full of water. You can see there, we talked about plants maintain that what's called turgidity in order to stay upright, to point their leaves toward the sun. And so when a cell is turgid, has that turgid pressure, think of like if you took a big trash bag and filled it full of air, all of a sudden the trash bag has shape and structure, and the pressure of the air inside the trash bag pushing out on the wall is what we would call that turgid pressure pushing out on the wall, giving the trash bag shape as well. And so that cell wall prevents the cell from bursting when that pressure is high. It helps the plant stand up against the force of gravity as well. So overall, giving the plant structure. It also provides a permeable barrier as well. In plants, there are these tiny little holes. Plants are multicellular structures. And so these cells are all combined together. They're all communicating with one another. And you find these tiny little passages called plasmodesmata that allow the passage of tiny materials, nutrients, wastes, ions, so forth, allow that passage. Plants still have a cell membrane also. So there's still that permeability happening, but the cell wall gives some extra added permeability as well. So animal cells do not have cell walls by definition. There are three types of organisms that have them: plants, fungi, and prokaryotes. Here are the examples of what are they composed of. Plants are composed of cellulose. Cellulose is a complex carbohydrate, which you see here. fungi are composed of a carbohydrate called chitin, which is, again, just another polysaccharide. Chitin is also what makes up exoskeletons for insects as well, and arthropods. So a very strong protein. Again, a structural kind of protein, or not protein, excuse me, polysaccharide. And so used for building things as opposed to, for energy. And then over here we have peptidoglycan, which peptidoglycan is a protein slash sugar mixture. Peptido means peptide bond protein, glycan, sugar. So this is a polymer of sugar and amino acids. These form the cell walls of bacteria.